made words in my mouth and the meditations of our hearts. Be always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer.
Amen.
I have on this table three cups, three mugs that look entirely different. So their appearance is different, but they all serve the same function. They're to hold liquid. It might be hot chocolate, it might be coffee, it might be tea, it could be water. So they all serve a particular function. But their function and their purpose is not fulfilled until they pour the contents out on the recipient. Several years ago, I followed a book by Joyce Rupp called The Cup of Our Life. And she used the metaphor of a cup to talk about our spiritual lives. And it was a 6-week meditation, basically, on cups. So I thought I would use that to talk about what we heard in the scriptures and what I think God is speaking to us as the church. In our passage from Jeremiah, we hear words of lament and tears and sorrow and hurt and calling out that hurt. And we don't know if it's Jeremiah's voice or God's or mingled together, which it probably was mingled together. When God called Jeremiah, you remember from several weeks ago, Jeremiah protested, "But I'm only a boy." He felt completely inadequate for the task of being God's prophet, his spokesperson. But God wanted to use Jeremiah as his vessel. And the vessel was to contain the word of God to God's people. And the word of God to God's people was a hard word. He was to pronounce judgment on the people and coming devastation, and then much later, restoration, much later. It was a hard word that he was to deliver, and he was not liked for it. They wanted to do away with the messenger who brought these hard words. But he said it later in Jeremiah. He said, if I keep it to myself, then my bones are set on fire. I've got to speak. He had to pour out what God was telling him to tell his people. And what was happening is God had showered down upon the people of Judah and Jerusalem great riches. They had a temple. They had their land. They had wealth. But the priests and the prophets were not being faithful to what had been given to them. And the priests, the prophets, and the people, with their wealth, were hoarding it for themselves. And the poor were suffering. And because they did not amend their ways, what they had was going to be taken from them. And they would be like an empty cup. When Paul was writing to Timothy, Timothy was a young person who was to be an overseer of a local church, what we would call a church today. So Paul was pouring out to Timothy what he had gained himself. Timothy was to be a steward. Just as Jeremiah had been a steward, Timothy was to be a steward of the good news of Jesus Christ. And he was to be faithful with what he had been given. As you know, Paul was a little rough around the edges. And Paul was a zealous persecutor of the followers of the way, the followers of Jesus. But Jesus chose Paul to be his special vessel, his apostle to the Gentiles. So the zeal that Paul had for destruction became zeal for building up of the body of Christ. And he faithfully performed that service. He poured out his life for the sake of the gospel, even as Jesus had poured out his life for Paul. We too are inheritors of great riches. We have the Hebrew scriptures, some of their traditions. They were handed down generation after generation to those who would receive them. We have the scriptures and the traditions of those in the early church and all through Christian history up to today. These are great riches. Every time we come to worship, we have wonderful hymns. We have prayers. We have the liturgy. We have the sacraments. We have this space. It's all gift. It's blessing. And we're to be vessels who oversee that, to be stewards of those things. However, sometimes we may feel like we're empty. We have nothing to offer. Well, rejoice, because if you are empty, you can be filled. Sometimes our cup is so full of bitterness and anger and disappointment and hurt that there's no room. So we have to empty that stuff out so we can be filled to the fullest. Sometimes we feel like we have nothing to offer. We're just kind of plain, ordinary folks. Well, take heart. That's how Jeremiah felt. And God used him in a mighty way. And then some of us may feel like we're pretty rough around the edges. We're kind of clumsy with our attempts to serve. But be encouraged, so was Paul. And look what God did with Paul. This time of the year, the church often talks about stewardship in a more direct way than the rest of the year. To be a steward is to take responsibility and use wisely and for the right purposes that which is entrusted to that person. We have so much entrusted to us. God has showered us with his blessings. Our cup runs over with blessings. And we're to be good stewards of those things. So, what do we have to offer? The blessings that we've received. And as you know, a cup has a function, but its purpose is not fulfilled until it pours itself out. And the same is true with us. Some of us have been blessed with great wealth. What can we do with those resources to help the church and to help those outside our walls, to help God's people and serve God? All of us can give something, and I'm sure we'll be hearing more about that in the days and weeks to come. All of us can give something. For God has given us all things. Yes, we work hard. But God has given us the ability and the liberty to work. And then he offers all of that to us. And then out of gratitude, we're to give back a portion to him. Have we received mercy and compassion at some point in our lives? We can share mercy and compassion with others. You have a lot of free time? That's a gift. How can we use our free time in service to God and others? Perhaps you have a car. Some people don't. Or some people can't drive anymore. We can use our cars to transport people who need that. We have spiritual gifts. All of us have spiritual gifts. And they differ. They look different. We look different on the outside. But Christ has planted in each one of us, given each one of us exactly what we need to serve him for a particular time, perhaps in a particular place, but certainly in a particular way. But the greatest blessing of all is the blessing of Jesus in us, the hope of glory. We have the life of the world. We have the living waters of Jesus Christ in us. Every time we come to church and we come to the altar rail to receive communion, we put out our empty hands. We're offering up ourselves to God. And we have placed in our hands Jesus. Jesus places himself in our hands, the body of Christ. When we consume the body of Christ and we drink his blood, we are one with him. We become one with him. He dwells in us. He lives in us. And as Joyce Rupp says in her book of devotions and meditations, we become the love song of God to the world. We become cups of blessing. How will we pour ourselves out to a world that's thirsting for life, for peace, for hope, for compassion, for mercy, for Jesus? If you'll notice on your bulletin, the author's name, the artist's name, is Nancy Cupp. I just noticed that yesterday. How will we serve? How will we be poured out? How will we be faithful stewards? Amen.